Very good morning, all of you. I am Dr. M.C. Nataraja, professor from the Department of Civil Engineering, Ramayya Institute of Technology, MSRIT, Bangalore. I welcome all my students to session 2 of the module 5. The subject is Design of Structural Elements, Steel Structural Elements, 18CV61. Friends, in the last class, I was discussing about the behavior of a laterally restrained beam, and in fact we have seen the different types of beams, the classifications of beams based on different criterias, and also we have seen how the stress distribution across the cross section changes and how the sections can be classified from the point of bending behavior as plastic section, compact section, semi-compact section and slender section. So with these few background, so let us see what is the behavior of a laterally restrained beam. In fact, the behavior of a laterally restrained beam I discussed in the previous class in greater details. So where I have shown what exactly the behavior with respect to the bending in the lateral direction. In fact, I have shown one photograph where the beam is being tested in the laboratory. Kindly see the cross section of the beam. It looks like a I section here, and when you apply the load at the center and when the load is applied beyond certain limit, kindly see the behavior of the top flange, the compression part of the beam. So the entire beam is bending in one particular plane, but if you see only the compression part, so the compression part of the beam is tending to move in the lateral direction, and at the same time the deflection in the vertical plane is also happening. So this is where the behavior of the beam which is out of plane comes into picture. So that is where the behavior of a laterally unsupported beam comes into picture. So this is where the lateral torsional buckling effect comes into picture, and this is not the problem I'm interested as far as this particular presentation is concerned. So the discussion is more confined to the behavior of a laterally restrained beam where the beam cannot bend in the lateral direction. So this is where the example which I mentioned in the previous class, where the beam itself is embedded inside the concrete, where the beam is confined by the surrounding concrete, or a roof slab is being cast over the beam where the compression flange is completely anchored to the concrete. So in such situation, when you apply the load on the beam bends only in the vertical plane. So the plane of bending is not going to deflect in the lateral direction. So that is what the problem I am interested, and with respect to the laterally supported beam, so the discussion will be continued. Now kindly see the cross section. So when the beam gets completely plastified, so where it is undergoing yielding because of the bending effect, it is being referred to as the flexural yielding. The distribution of the stress over the entire depth is yield stress. And corresponding to this situation, if you see, the extreme fiber has undergone substantial deformation leading to substantial straining effect. So this is what the behavior of a laterally supported beam where the cross section completely yields. The beam is not susceptible for the lateral buckling. So this is the case of a laterally restrained beam or a laterally supported beam. Now before I go to the behavior of the beam, so let us see the various modes of failure of beam. So I have given some pictorial representations. So this is what the beam subjected to load, simply supported, it bends. When the beam bends like this, what happens to the different elements of the cross section? So from the point of yielding and from the point of buckling, so that need to be appreciated. And we also have a beam, kindly say, similar to the above beam, but we are applying the same load at the center. The beam is bending vertically down with respect to the horizontal plane. So that is where, with respect to the vertical plane, that is where ZY comes into picture. So the vertical plane, the plane of bending is confined to one particular plane, but here the plane of bending is not confined to one plane. It is partially going lateral deflection. So this is where the behavior of a laterally restrained beam comes into picture. Now kindly see the box section. In fact, I discussed the importance of the box section also in the previous module. So because the width of the element is somewhat substantial compared to the thickness, where width to thickness ratio is more, so there is a very possibility that the element undergo local buckling. And this is what the buckling wave, series of buckling wave will be able to see in the compression part. And this is what the behavior of a beam if at all the width to thickness ratio is substantial beyond certain limit. So obviously the element is in the form of a slender type, or it could be a semi-compact type where complete plastification of the element is not going to happen. In fact, the entire cross section is not going to yield. Now if you take the example of a plate girder where the depth of the girder is somewhat larger, it is a deep girder. So obviously the depth of the girder is quite large. And if you take the rolled section where the depth of the section is something like 400 mm, 450 mm, 500 mm, and it can even go up to 600 mm, anything beyond that we don't have the rolled section, we need to fabricate the section. And that is where 1 meter depth, 1.5 meter depth and 2 meter depth of the girder comes into picture. And compared to that 2 meter depth, and if you see the thickness, 10 mm, 12 mm, 15 mm, whatever the thickness we are going to give for the web, that is so large that the web of the element will undergo buckling. So that is where the shear buckling comes into picture. So this is the location rather close to the support. So where we have substantial amount of shear force, and the central portion we have the maximum bending moment, and here near the support the web undergoes the shear buckling. So this is what the secondary failure of the element comes into picture. So the full plastification of the vertical section here at the center is not going to happen. So even at the support also the full plastification is not going to happen. So the element is undergoing premature failure. And kindly see the situation of a simply supported beam subjected to the concentrated load at the center. So when the section undergoes yielding, so there is every possibility that the flange element alone undergo some sort of a yielding. So this is the flange yielding. The yielding is spreading, but more yielding is happening in the flange. So it is the yielding failure of the compression flange. So that is what I have represented here. And sometimes some sort of a crushing can also happen here depending on the type of the material. So if the material is ductile in nature, so it is the yielding, and by chance some sort of a brittle behavior comes into picture, we will be noticing some sort of a crushing at this particular location. So this is what the situation in case of a RCC beam, where at the center, the toward the top, concrete undergo crushing. Kindly see here, so in case of a steel beam, again a simply supported one, so here the element is undergoing shear yielding. So as I mentioned, so shear yielding is generally confined to the vertical element, so that is a web element. So there is a very possibility that the web element yields rather than undergoing buckling. So in case of a deep girder, so it is the buckling of the element where the element is not going to yield. The stress causing the buckling is substantially less than the yield stress. That's what the behavior of a plate girder. But whereas in case of a conventional rolled section, the end being the web undergo yielding, and that yielding, since it is happening near the support, the yielding is initiated by the shear. So that is what is referred to as the shear yielding. And kindly see the behavior with respect to this simply supported beam, and kindly see the cross section near the center, some portion near the center. So this is where the web is undergoing crushing. The flange is buckling, but the web is undergoing crushing. So this is what is referred to as the crushing of the web. And probably the flange might have undergone yielding at that particular instant of time. But what is important is to see what is the behavior of the web at this particular location. And also kindly see if the width of the flange is quite substantial, as we have in this particular case. This is the outstand, as I mentioned, the projection of the flange beyond the web to its thickness. If that is substantial, then there is every possibility that the flange can undergo buckling before the plastification. Again, if you see the stress in the flange, it is substantially less than the yield stress. So depending on what is happening in the cross section, whether it is the bending effect or the shear effect, whether the beam is some sort of a shallow beam or a deep beam, so it is either the maximum stress that controls the behavior where the yielding happens, otherwise the buckling can happen at a lesser load where the induced stress is substantially less than the yield stress. So web buckling, that is where the shear buckling at a stress less than the shear yield, and this is where the flange buckling at a stress less than the yield strength of the material comes into picture. So this is the buckling behavior, and this is also the buckling behavior, but the stress causing this buckling is the shear stress, but here it is the bending stress. Now this is the concept of laterally supported beam. So laterally supported is also sometimes referred to as the restrained beam. The beam is restrained from bending in the lateral direction. So one example, as I mentioned in the previous session, is this one, where the I section is completely embedded in the concrete. So when the beam as a whole bends, it's a sort of composite behavior. So this is where the encased steel beam in the concrete comes into picture. So the flange of the beam is not going to bend in the lateral direction, and there is no provision as such because there is no free space surrounding the element. So in fact, it is completely restrained. And if you see the second beam, so where a slab is resting on the beam, in fact, we have seen this type of sketches in the previous discussion also. I have introduced the shear connectors also to see that the horizontal resistance against the shear is increased. Thereby, when the slab pushes the beam or series of beams, the beams bends only with respect to vertical plane, being the plane of bending for that I section, where the flange is not going to move in the lateral direction. If at all any buckling happens in a cross section, it is only that portion of the beam which is in compression can buckle. So we need to discuss only the compression part. So maybe this is the compression part. Please see the cursor. So that compression part is not going to buckle, and the behavior of the tension part and the compression part is more or less same, and you can allow the stress in the beam in such a way that more and more of bending we will be able to see. And because of this, maximum stress equal to yield stress can be realized over the entire depth of the section, and that is where the fully plastic capacity of the beam comes into picture. So this is where the importance of laterally supported beam, where the beam can be designed for MP. But if it undergoes lateral buckling, the maximum moment decreases substantially. And this is what the situation of a shear stud. So this is more or less similar to this, but see here. So we also have some shear elements welded all along the length of the beam, so which is again embedded in the concrete, and thereby the resistance of the compression part increases substantially. So here also, so the I section undergoes yielding. So there is no bending of the compression part happening in the lateral direction, and that is what is called as lateral buckling. So the lateral buckling is prevented. Lateral buckling is restrained. It's all because of the type of support what we have provided here. And it is quite obvious that so the beam bending is confined to one plane and nothing happens in the lateral direction. Now, as far as the limit states for laterally restrained beams are concerned, so we need to consider the following limit state. So limit state of flexure, limit state of shear, limit state of bearing, and limit state of serviceability. So all these things I'll be discussing one by one. So let us take the first case of limit state of flexure, and this I have explained in the module 1 also, and many of the diagrams I have taken from module 1, and it is rather a sort of repetition for those students who have attended my earlier classes of the module 1 in plastic method of analysis. Again, a simply supported beam subjected to a series of concentrated loads. The beam bends, you know the variation of bend moment and shear force along the length of the span. And the diagram what I have shown is the deflected profile, which is the profile of the beam after the bending is over. And this is a small infinitesimal element, so between two vertical sections have presented here. And you can see the neutral axis somewhere near the mid depth of the section, where the depth of the beam is h. So the small element is subjected to moment m from both the sides. So the top portion gets compressed, and as a result of that we have the compressive stress distributed in this linear manner. So the extreme fiber stress is maximum at the top, being compression, and at the bottom it is tension. So this is where the Bernoulli-Euler equation comes into picture. So m by I is equal to f by y is equal to e by r, and with reference to that equation we have seen many other the parameters of analysis and design in the plastic method of analysis. In fact, we also have seen the salient points along the idealized stress strain diagram. So this is what the idealized diagram from the point of plastic method of analysis. So this is the behavior of a perfectly elastic and perfectly plastic material. So if you take the portion in the vertical direction, so that is where the elastic behavior comes into picture. The stress is proportional to strain, so the amount of strain is rather less compared to the rate of increase in the stress. But if you see here, there is no increase in stress, but the deformation or the strain is increasing continuously. But if you take the point 2, this is corresponding to the onset of the yielding, so the extreme fiber stress just reaches the yield stress Fy, but continuous further deformation leading to redistribution of stress across the cross section is happening, and this is the point where some fibers in the extreme top and bottom yields, but still we have fibers near the center still elastic. If you allow the load to increase on the beam, it is not possible to increase the load, but during the process the member, the portion of the element, undergoes further yielding, and where the depth of the plastification of the cross section keep on increases, but still we have a small portion near the core being elastic. So this is where elastoplastic comes into picture. It is just corresponding to the first yield, and that yielding keep on increases, and finally corresponding to the point 4, where the entire cross section has completely yielded. So from point 2 to point 4, so you are completely increasing the load on the beam. The moment carrying capacity of the beam is also increasing in a non-linear manner, and corresponding to the situation for the cross section has attained the plastic moment, and it further undergo deformation beyond point 4. So that is where further continuous deformation of the portion that has yielded comes into picture. So with reference to this, if you see the distribution of the stress and strain across the cross section, so under the elastic condition the strain distribution is linear. Extreme top has a strain less than yield strain, but the stress is again proportional, so that is also less than the yield stress. At any level below the extreme top or extreme bottom, at some distance, so the stress and strain both is linear, and knowing what is maximum at the extreme top, so you will be able to calculate this stress and strain at any level. If you increase the load further and the point is 2 across the cross section, where the distribution of the stress is like this, extreme fiber is having the yield stress, but otherwise all other fibers the stress is less than yield stress. If you increase the load further, so it is plastic at the top and bottom, and near the center, as I mentioned, it is elastic. So elastoplastic behavior comes into picture, and also see what is the portion that has yielded plastified. So only this hatched portion is completely plastified, but otherwise the central portion of the web is still elastic. And see the distribution of the yielding spreading across the section from top and bottom. So this is where the redistribution of the stress comes into picture, where the moment on the beam is increased continuously. The load is increased on the beam, but kindly see the strain distribution. The strain keep on increases, and only the extreme fiber undergo maximum strain. The question of strain distributing over the depth doesn't come into picture, the strain keep on increases, but the plasticification of the section over the depth happens, where stress equal to Fy, the whole cross section attains yielding. So that's where the condition for the point on the stress strain diagram for comes into picture. So it is the strain distribution, and this is what the stress distribution across the cross section. So fully plastified cross section will be having, where the moment carrying capacity of the section is MP. And also kindly see what happens to the point where the entire area is area of the plastified portion at the top and bottom is getting concentrated. So this is where, kindly see, so the yielding of the top has just started corresponding to point 2. This is what the point, and here elastoplastic behavior comes into picture. This is a complete plastification. And kindly see this particular point, what I have shown as a block dot, sorry, as a block point. So this is where the centroid of the top flange and also a small portion of the wave comes into picture. Maybe this point should have been slightly downwards, and this point also should have been slightly towards the centroidal axis. So this is what the point that represents the centroidal point, the centroid of this hatched part. And kindly see here, so the top T is plastified, bottom T is plastified with respect to the horizontal axis, which is passing through the center. And also, as I mentioned, this axis is also referred to as the equal area axis. And see the centroid. The centroid of the top flange and the web, as far as the top T is concerned, is assumed to be somewhere here. So it is slightly pushed towards the centroid. And this is where the entire force connected with the compression, because of the distribution of Fy over 50% of the area, which is compression. And similarly, the distribution of the stress over the bottom, which is tensile in nature. And if you see where exactly the concentrated effect of the force because of the stress getting distributed over 50% of the bottom area of the section, it is concentrated at this location. And that area is located at a distance of ZT, being the lever arm of that force with respect to center. And this is the lever arm with respect to the compressive force. Otherwise, if you add these two, ZC plus ZT, so this is the total distance from the point, this point at the top to this point at the bottom, being the two points where the resultant of the compressive force and the tensile forces are acting. So these two forces are equal. So one of the force multiplied by the distance separating the two force, so being the lever arm. And that is where the internal moment of resistance of the section comes into picture. So with this concept, so we have derived the expression for MP. So MP is equal to Fy into ZP. And we also have seen as to what ZP is. So ZP is equal to 50% of the area, because we are calculating this with respect to equal area axis. And that is where Ay2 into Y1 bar plus Y2 bar comes into picture. So that is where the centroidal that is where the distance of the resultant of the compressive area and the tensile area with respect to the equal area axis comes into picture. Now kindly see the distribution of the bending moment and the distribution of the curvature. How exactly the curvature from left to the right over the entire span is changing as the load is increased on the beam. So we need to increase the load, the moment increases, bending moment increases. And the nature of the bending moment diagram also, you can see it is triangular in nature, because we have the point load at the center, and that moment increases further and further and further. And this is the point corresponding to 4, where full plastification is happening. No change in the bending moment diagram, but the magnitude of the moment keep on changes. So here the moment, as you know, in case of a simply supported beam subjected to concentrated load, it is WL by 4. But the WL by 4 becomes WL by 4 corresponding to full plastification. That is where one plastic hinge comes here. And taking that into consideration, we have solved these problems in the plastic method of analysis from the point of derivation of the equations. And kindly say, so this is the cross section where the moment is maximum. And anywhere across the depth, if you see, the stress is elastic only. At the top and at bottom, the stress is maximum, but it has not attained the yield value. And kindly see the second situation where the top and bottom stress at this section of maximum bending moment has just attained the yield. So I am just showing a small dark dot. So this is what the dark dot, so indicating that the yielding has just started, corresponding to the second bending moment diagram, and corresponding to that the curvature of the beam and how it is varying is like this. So kindly see the curvature has increased substantially here, the radius of curvature, the slope. In fact, all these things we have discussed again in the module 1. The radius of curvature is r, the reciprocal of r is what the curvature. The curvature is directly proportional to the slope, and we also have seen as to what the slope, the tangent to the deflected profile at the support. And if you increase the load further, so elastoplastic behavior, so the plastic behavior is more near the center, and that plastic behavior spreads to the left and right along the span, and the depth of the plastification decreases, but it spreads further and further. But this is the point where only the extreme fiber has yielded, but over the depth nothing has happened. If you take the section still away from the center, so the entire depth is elastic in nature. And corresponding to the point 4 where the entire cross section has plastified, kindly see this particular cross section. The central cross section is completely plastified, but otherwise if you take sections, series of sections either to the left or to the right going for some distance, so you have substantial amount of plastification, and that decreases and decreases, and finally we have a point where just one fiber has reached the yield. Now if you see the locus of those points where the yielding has just started, and if you try to draw that locus and over the entire length of the yielding either to the left or to the right, and you are going to get some sort of a distribution which is being shown in the block color like this. So that is what the plastic hinge, and that plastic hinge has certain length, and that length in a simply supported beam is L by 3. That too if the beam is subjected to point load at the center, and if the beam is subjected to UDL simply supported, the length of the plastic hinge is 1 upon root 3. 1 by 3 will become 1 by root 3. So in fact the length of the plastic hinge depends not only on the end condition, it also depends on how the load is distributed. And these derivations also we have seen in the first module in plastic method of analysis. And corresponding to the third situation where it is elastoplastic, kindly see the curvature. One particular nature of the curvature, it is trying to take a different direction where the curvature is becoming opposite, and the curvature is increasing further and further and further, and when it is about to yield completely, the increase in curvature is quite substantial and leading to failure. So that is where a continuous infinite increase in rotation, continuous increase in rotation causing failure by mechanism comes into picture, and that is what the situation corresponding to the condition 4. Bending moment diagram, absolute maximum bending moment, situation of plastification and spread of plastification along the span over L by 3 in a simply supported beam, and finally the change in curvature, and that curvature increasing continuously leading to collapse, and thereby we have the concept of mechanism, and many of these things were discussed in the first module. Now if you take the deflection, the deflection is maximum near the center, the deflection is also increasing as the load is increased, and corresponding to those four points along the idealized stress strain diagram, and this is what the situation corresponding to the failure. Corresponding to failure, so where we have a plastic hinge, and where the depth of this depth in the sense, so this is the magnitude of the deflection at the time of failure, it is absolute maximum. And if you increase the load further, so continuous rotation of the plastic hinge leading to failure of the beam into two parts, where we will be able to see the left link and the right link comes into picture. And this is where the first yield moment, and then the increase in moment in a nonlinear manner and going up to MP comes into picture. And if you see the difference, from MY to MP, so that is where the depth because of the shape comes into picture. And if the shape factor is substantial, then this depth is also substantial. In case of I section, this depth is very small because the shape factor is hardly 1.1 to 1.5. But in case of rectangle, diamond type of sections, or even triangular section, so we have more than 2, going up to 2.34 in triangle. So this depth is quite considerable. So what the depth you have here, like MY, so if this depth, if you take it as 1 in rectangle, 50% of this depth is what this depth is. Whereas in case of I section, so this depth where you have the nonlinear variation of the yield from first yield point to the fully plastic situation, this is only 10 to 15% of this yield moment. But in case of a triangular section, so the depth here is 1.34 times, means more than 100% compared to this. So this is what the depth, and equal to that and much more than that is what the depth over which we have the nonlinear variation of the moment to curvature relationship. So many of these things plays an important role. And if you have more of area near the centroid, near the core of the section, so the shear factor also increases. But if you have an I section where the web is assumed to be not existing, where the thickness of the web is zero, we have only two flanges, then this is what the point MP and MY, both MY and MP coincides and will not be having anything beyond MY possible. So at that MY only the full plastification happens immediately when the load is further increased, and there is no scope for increasing the stress beyond yield and reaching the full plastification. So full plastification happens rather quickly, indicating that so additional moment beyond yielding is not there in such type of I section where web is assumed to be of negligible thickness. And for these four conditions and how to calculate the moment carrying capacity is being explained here, my dear friends. So this is what F into Z, any stress corresponding to elastic multiplied by the elastic section modulus, the moment of inertia divided by the extreme fiber distance. So if you go to the second situation where the first yielding has started from top and bottom, so it is the yield stress multiplied by still the elastic section modulus, because if you see over the depth, the stress distribution is elastic. And this is what the formula for elastoplastic. So let's not worry much about this. But when you go to the bottom, so this formula we have actually derived in module 1. So this is Fy, and what I have mentioned within the bracket is the section modulus. So section modulus with respect to compression, section modulus with respect to tension. So where area and the corresponding distance comes into picture. So that is where the first moment of area above and below the equal area axis comes into picture. And this is where the plastic section modulus, and if you multiply with Fy, it is the plastic capacity of the section. And of course the importance of sections from the point of shear factor, so this has been discussed. And now coming to the shear and the distribution of shear, the stress and strain part, if you see, it is something like this. So this is what the distribution of the bending stress is corresponding to some situation, elastic behavior. A similar type of variation of the strain comes into picture. So let's not worry about the strain for flexure and the strain for shear. It's only the stress distribution what I am showing here. So distribution of the bending stress over the depth for the elastic condition. And as I mentioned, the distribution of the shear stress will be parabolic in nature over the rectangle or cross section. But here it is having a plated sections where widths are somewhat substantial here. So over the depth of the flange, that's where the thickness of the flange comes into picture, a small nonlinear part comes into picture. The width B at this junction, it is reducing drastically from BF to the thickness of the web. So absolutely, if you see the equations which will give you the x value of stress at any level with respect to the neutral axis, so we have the thickness coming in the denominator, and since the thickness is decreasing all of a sudden, so we have a substantial increase in the stress coming into pitch. This is what a sudden increase in shear stress. And again, over the depth of the web, so up to the centroidal axis, the stress distribution becomes nonlinear. And if you go to the other side, again the same nonlinearity, but so we have the distribution. What happens at the top? The same thing in the bottom, but in the reverse manner. Again, horizontal distribution and then nonlinear distribution. So this is where some sort of a parabolic distribution comes into picture. So let us see what really happens from the point of plastification. So if you take some sections where you have both the effect of bending moment and shear force. So there are sections where we have both bending moment and shear force, but if you have a simply supported beam where the bending moment is maximum, you don't have the shear force, but near the support the shear force is maximum. That is where this stress alone will go, but you don't have this distribution. But if you just go to one third of the span, either to the left or to the right from that, so we have both bending moment and shear force, and kindly see what happens in such situations. So addition of the bending stress and the shear stress happens, and at some point in time, so the plastification of the section is going to take place faster. And kindly see here the plastification of the flange happening, not necessarily because of the bending effect, so it is for the combined effect of bending and shear. But when you see here, so this is the distribution of the stress, the bending distribution of the stress, and of course we also have a separate distribution of the shear stress. So definitely when this stress is added on to this, the distribution will become somewhat nonlinear, and definitely the plastification happens at a moment which is far, far less compared to the plastic moment capacity of the suction. So that is where the effect of the shear on the plastic moment capacity comes into picture. But if the shear effect is somewhat less, where the magnitude of this stress is somewhat less compared to the magnitude of this, so probably the full plastification can happen where the shear is not having much influence. But if you have a substantial shear, then so the plastification of the web itself will happen because of the shear, and definitely the plastic moment capacity of the section we are not able to realize because some area of the web is being eaten away by the shear. So that portion of the web contributing to the shear yielding is not available for the flexural effect, and that is where the moment carrying capacity decreases. So that is what the effect of the shear on the plastic capacity. So many of these things we need to get it from textbook. So a lot of theory need to be studied, understand the concept and some of the techniques with which many of these things happens. Basics of strength of material is a important thing to know more about these things. And in fact, we have the expressions to calculate what is the shear capacity of the cross section. So this is the average shear stress. So the shear force at any cross section divided by the area resisting the shear, that is the web area, comes into picture. So that is where the depth of the web and the thickness of the web comes into picture. So what I want to tell you is, so what is this average shear stress? So this average shear stress increases as the load is increased on the beam, or when the shear force near the support increases. For what condition of the stress the real yielding starts? So this is where the student should be very careful. The yielding of the material starts at Fy. And what is Fy? So Fy is the yield strength of the material based on the tension or compression. So this is where the tension yielding or compression yielding comes into picture. In case of steel, because the material is perfectly plastic, where the behavior in tension and compression is more or less same, comparable, so the yield stress is Fy. In terms of numerical value, it may be 250 or 300 depending on the grade. So at 250, the material yields in tension and compression. But what is the stress that is required to cause yielding of the cross section because of the shear? The magnitude of that shear is definitely less compared to the magnitude of the stress that causes the yielding by direct tension or compression. So that is where the shear yield capacity of the section comes into picture, my dear friends, and that is taken as Fy upon root 3. So this is many a times called as octahedral stress. So there are many such concepts of failure criteria comes into picture. So again, I suggest good students who really wants to explore more and who are interested in pursuing their studies further and wants to take some competitive examination. So we need to know many of these things. So 1 upon root 3, if you take it to the numerator, it is 0.58. So that's where 0.6 of Fy comes into picture. So 60% of the yield stress is what the stress near the support which can cause the yielding of the web in the form of a failure. So the shear yield stress is 60% of the tensile yield stress. So that is where the force that is calculated based on this is what the maximum shear capacity of the support condition, where the web is yielding but the magnitude of the stress causing the yielding is 0.6 of Fy into area of the web. So this is what is being referred to as the shear capacity. So in fact, there are two cases. What really happens when the shear is less than this? So that is where full plastification of the cross section can happen. By chance, if you have a shear near the support which is much more than this, then your beam is not able to attain the full plastified moment, where the moment capacity need to be reduced. And many of these concepts I will be discussing when I take up the IS 800 provisions from the point of design. So let us wait for some time to know more about this. But as a part of introduction, I think so these are the three equations which tell you about the shear capacity of the beam when you want to design by limit state method. And of course, so we have the combined shear and bending, and depending on the type of the cross section, so we have these equations. So this is the design moment capacity, and this design moment capacity is less than or equal to 1.2 times the maximum flexural capacity, and beta is being given by this. So where the shear at a particular cross section is exceeding so 60% of the shear. So I would like to explain these things further when I take some design considerations as a part of IS 800. So till that point in time, so please remember that we have few equations something like this, where the moment carrying capacity of the cross section, how that can be determined in the presence of shear and bending, is something like this. Now let us go to the next case, where we need to check the behavior of the section from the point of buckling. And as I mentioned, buckling need to be considered at those cross sections where it is subjected to point load or the concentrated load. The point load generally comes into picture near the support, where the entire load on the beam, when it is transferred to the support, it acts as a reaction, and the reaction being the concentrated load. And at that level, the entire depth of the beam can undergo buckling. There are two types of buckling that need to be discussed as a part of this, so which we can see in the subsequent slides. And generally the beam is subjected to UDL, but in addition to UDL, so there are instances where along the span we'll be applying heavy concentrated loads, and of course the load is to be transferred to the flange by putting a plate under the concentrated load. And depending on what type of plate, what size of plate, the buckling of the web is being controlled. So what I'm explaining as buckling of web, whether the vertical buckling of the web or the column buckling, and also we have another buckling called as the crippling, which happens near the junction. All these things need to be considered, not only at the support where you have substantial reaction, even along the span where you have put the concentrated load. So many deep girders, so there are instances that we need to check for concentrated effect of the load, especially in case of gantry girder as well. So this is what is referred to as the vertical buckling. So this happens in the vertical direction, and this buckling happens in the web, and where the web undergo buckling in the form of a column. So this is also called as web buckling, column buckling, and vertical buckling. So because of the effect of the reaction. So this reaction being the load, so that is being shown on the cross section, shown as far as the end of the beam is concerned with respect to the plate, so on which the beam is supported. So kindly see the nature of the buckling. So the buckling is spread over certain length, so which we'll be able to see if you see through the longitudinal length of the beam. So we'll be able to see that certain length of the web near the mid depth has undergone bending, out of plane bending. So kindly see, so this is what the original web vertical, with respect to the vertical, so it has bent outside. So it is a sort of out of plane bending, and that is where the buckling of the web comes into picture. So for this web, the top flange and bottom flange can be regarded as a sort of fixity. So where web is connected to flange and flange is connected to web, so definitely this is the fixity point. So the depth being a column, so connected to the flange as if it is fixed at top and bottom, so we have the fixed beam type of behavior, and that is how the buckling nature. So the buckling nature is exactly similar to the bending profile what you have seen in a fixed beam, so subjected to some type of a loading over the span. And also see another interesting thing here. So at this particular point, so where the end of the plate, this is the shoe plate, so or the cover plate, so on which we have kept the beam. So at this particular point, so the spread of the stress increases at an angle of 45 degrees. So this is what is called as the dispersion angle. So this is how the stress is getting dispersed towards the center of the web. So over this it is maximum, and the spreading of that stress up to the mid depth happens till this particular point. So this is what the length of the web near the mid depth based on this angle of dispersion need to be considered. So this width multiplied by the thickness, so that is what the area of the web. So we have to imagine that area with this width multiplied by the thickness of the web. So that is where the stress is distributed because of this R. R divided by what is the distribution of the stress. So that is where the total force resisted by the central portion of the web comes into picture. So this is what the concept we need to discuss to know what exactly the load carrying capacity, so that can be permitted as a reaction. So based on what is the depth to the thickness. So if the depth to the thickness is larger, so where the susceptibility of the element to undergo failure is more likely, so obviously the shear capacity to web decreases because it is buckling like a slender column. So as the depth increases for a given thickness, so the column effect is very similar to that of the long column effect. So because of that, the stress controlling the behavior decreases, and obviously at a lesser load as a reaction, the buckling takes place. So that is where the limiting strength of the beam near the support comes into picture. So this is what you need to appreciate. So I will take up the exact derivation of this formula in the next class. So whatever I showed as the width of the plate, so this is where the bearing stress is acting, and the other bearing stress as a reaction to this near the center, so over the same width but the extended width based on this 45 degree dispersion. So we need to calculate what is this B1 and also what is this N1, so which is the extended length. So because this is 45 degree dispersion, so the mid depth, if the depth of the beam is known, so what is this depth we will be able to calculate, and the same depth as a horizontal if you take it, so that is where it is 45 degree, and calculation of this B1 and N1 is also easy. So that is what the width over which this stress is acting. Kindly see B1 and N1 multiplied by the thickness of the web. So that is where the thickness of the web comes into picture, and the stress which is really causing that buckling. So the stress which is really causing that buckling is to be obtained based on the column behavior. The column behavior of the web is controlled by the slenderness ratio. And that slenderness ratio is nothing but the effective length. What is that effective length? If the length of the web is the length of the column or the effective height of the column, if the actual height, the visible height is taken as D, and the top flange and bottom flange being the fixity, what is the effective height or the effective depth? So we have seen that that effective height is 0.7 of D, and of course divided by the radii of gyration. So the effective length by Ry is what the slenderness ratio. So we can also calculate what is Ry. So Ry is under the root of Iy by A. So you know what is Iy. So taking the elemental width of the web, so it is BD cube by 12. So where the depth is the thickness and B is the unit width. So unit width into thickness cube. So is what the moment of inertia, of course, by 12. And area being that unit width B and T. And if you simplify this expression, we are going to get T by 2 root 3. And definitely, the further simplification of this leads to the slenderness ratio, 2.5 times of T by T. So from the point of handling the problem, to check for the web buckling, so you need to identify what is the slenderness ratio just by remembering this formula, 2.5 D by T. And corresponding to this and knowing the nature of the buckling curve corresponding to this column behavior, you will be able to get the buckling stress referring to IS 800. So for that, we need to look for the appropriate table. And once that stress is identified for the grade of steel and for the slenderness ratio, put that value of stress here. So the remaining things are known from this diagram. So that too for the support reaction, where you have the dispersion happening in one particular direction, so you can calculate the maximum load that can be permitted just before the onset of the local buckling. And if this exceeds, the local buckling do happen and your structural element undergo failure and that is not permitted. So this is what the formula for single dispersion. But if you have a point load on the anywhere on the span acting on the beam, then we have the dispersion taking place in both the direction, and we will see what the formula and how the problem can be solved in the next class. So that is where the web buckling as an extended thing for the concentrated load comes into picture. And also we have the concept of web crippling happening, and some of these things we will tackle in greater details in the next class. So friends, I will stop at this stage. If you have any questions, you can ask. So thank you very much. Good night.